Welcome to worship on this Palm Sunday, also on this beginning of spring break. You are all invited after church to hop on a charter bus that'll be out front. We're heading to Florida.
They just got back.
Oh, boy. Also need to point out that the Johnsons are sitting on completely the wrong side of the church. Just thought I'd say that. Jan and Mark, welcome back. Good to see you guys. Anyways, thank you for coming today, and welcome back to all the snowbirds and people who have flown in from southern regions. We're glad that you're here. We gather in our prayer this morning for a few people. Barb Robotham, who's been on our prayers for years, struggling with her cancer a bit, just found out that she has two spots they found on her brain. She's doing well. She's actually in New Orleans right now on a trip. When she comes back, they're going to treat it with some radiation, and they feel very hopeful. But I thought I'd tell you that. John Kundell had a stroke this past week. He's up at Munson Hospital. And Jane said probably no visits quite yet, but she'll let us know how things progress and when he's more open to that. Is it Goob Robotham in our prayers? Cancer back, prayers for him. I'm asking prayers for our family. Lost my Aunt Marge, my dad's sister. And 96 years old, passed away 2 days ago. So prayers for her family too. Sarah Fought is in our prayers with cancer. Deb Golock's brother Tom had a stroke and some blockages. Prayers for Deb Golock's brother Tom. And Brian Roy is involved in a Kairos prison ministry in Lancaster, Ohio, and he just asked for our prayers. They have a big meeting, and they do wonderful work, chaplaincy work down there, so prayers for them. Flowers today are in thankfulness for Nancy Vanderlinde's birthday, and I don't know if you guys are going to be anyone heading toward Nancy's house. Feel free to take the flowers. They're just beautiful as we keep Nancy in our prayers. Rich Yates, Kelly Stapleton, Kathy Huffman having birthdays this week. So happy birthday to all of you guys. You already have the ears on, Kelly. That's nice. Many thanks to Jay Larson and Patty Wilson for providing treats for fellowship today. Jay said he was up most of the night baking. So I think that's really wonderful of Jay. Holy Week schedule. So when you leave and you know that you're not coming back, at least for 3 days in Jesus' case, you often have a dinner with your family and friends. So the Last Supper is Jesus' dinner. That's Maundy Thursday. So we're inviting you to a potluck at the church Maundy Thursday as we celebrate that Last Supper. Everything's going to take place down in the community hall. So we have a potluck meal, and then we just stay around our tables and we celebrate communion together. Advent Lutheran Church, some people from Advent are coming to join us this Maundy Thursday, so we will welcome them as well. That's 6 o'clock. Good Friday service, 7 p.m. As Jesus takes a last breath, we remember Good Friday, 7 p.m. worship service here in the sanctuary. I always say after Easter and Christmas, to me, Good Friday's the day. Don't miss it, because it's hard to celebrate what happens on Easter without remembering what happens on Good Friday. So we certainly welcome you. And then Easter, we start two services, 8:30 and 11. Someone said to me this morning, thank goodness, finally 11. I don't have to get up so early. And you 8:30 people are like, geez, we have to wait all day. So anyways, 8:30 and 11 starting next week, and we'll do that right on through till January again. So a new adult Bible study happening, devotional study down in the community hall around 11:15-ish, so grab a treat, grab a cup of coffee if you'd like to join the table in the community hall as a sign-on. And I think that's it, except the choir is going to lead the kids in kind of a processional thing today, being Maundy Thursday. As they wave palm branches, we'll do that as the kids walk around this morning. Ann?
Yeah. So just to let everybody know, the endowment committee met this morning. We had over $10,000 that we were going to allot to outside of Trinity. It all gets spent in ministries outside of Trinity. So they chose seven groups to allot those to. We had a youth endowment committee this morning meeting as well, and they decided that they were going to spend partial pay to send two kids to camp this year. Mm-hmm. So for those that don't know about these two groups, and maybe some of you don't, they sit with Schwab, and they are meant to grow in years where the market is good and some years not so great, but last year we had a great, it was a good market. So we had lots of money to spend. It's fabulous. So I'm going to let Paul talk about you a little bit.
Yeah, just quickly, as I think of any endowment, it's really an investment. Investing in our youth, which you think about all the issues in the world, they're going to have to solve a lot of those things. So there's a huge opportunity there. And think in terms of 50 years from now, the $100 that you give or whatever you can afford to give or whatever, that's still there. And the interest, half the interest off that every year is going back to the kids. So we really want to do some long-term investment in the kids, not just buying them pizza. You know, while that's important and stuff, but it's not what youth endowments are about. It's about really helping some people step out of their box, their comfort zone, and become really good individuals and future leaders of our church. So that's what the endowments are all about. So give when you can.
Thanks, Paul. You're not dissing pizza, though, or anything, are you? Great. Welcome to worship on this Palm Sunday as we begin the week called Holy Week. Would you please stand as we prepare our hearts? If we say we have no sin, we deceive ourselves and the truth is not in us. So let us confess our sin to God, who is faithful and just, and who has promised to forgive our sin and cleanse us from all unrighteousness.
Amen.
Most merciful God,
have mercy on us. We confess to you that we have sinned against you, God, word, and deed, by what we have done and by what we have not done. We have not trusted you with our whole heart. We have not loved one another in deed.
That we may live and serve you in newness of life through Jesus Christ, our light and our truth. Amen. With great joy, I proclaim to you that Almighty God, rich in mercy and abundant in love, forgives you all your sin and grants you newness of life in Jesus Christ.
Thanks be to God.
You can remain standing. We're going to be having the choir sing and the kids process. Feel free to wave. Thank you. Church, we're waving palms because it's Palm Sunday. How come we wave palms? What happened? How come? What did people do with the palms when Jesus came into town? Yeah? Did they wave palms? Because they were so excited. What do you guys do at parades? You guys ever go to the parade like in Frankfurt?
Yeah.
You ever wave at the people coming by?
I've had Frankfurt before.
You have?
Yeah.
Hi. Yeah, people were very excited because Jesus came to town, and they said, "He's our king! He's our king!" Yay! They were celebrating. Yeah, who's our king? We don't really have a king, do we? Unless we say it's Jesus, right?
It's
Jesus. Jesus is the king.
We
didn't
know.
I don't know about that. All right. Well, how about if we have a prayer? And then I think there's some things going on to, I think Kate and Vicky are going to take you guys down and they have some activities for you guys, all right? All right, let's pray, you guys. Gracious God, thank you for being with us. Thank you for helping us celebrate. And may we always take that celebration and turn it into love. Amen. All right. Would you guys like a treat? Why? Oh. Okay. Okay. Thank you. All right, guys, mind your ears. Thanks, guys. Gary Tranquil, you'll like this one. One of the kids said to me, just as it was ending, he said, "Why was the quarter? Oh shoot, I messed it up. Why was the coach mad?" The coach was mad because he wanted his quarterback. Oh. On that note, would you please stand and let us sing?
Oh,
Let us pray together today's prayer of the day.
Everlasting God, in your endless love for the human race, you sent our Lord Jesus Christ to take our nature and to suffer death on the cross. In your mercy, enable us to share in his obedience to your will and in the glorious victory of the resurrection.
Amen. Would you please be seated for today's reading?
From Isaiah chapter 50. The Lord God has given me the tongue of a teacher, that I may know how to sustain the weary with a word. Morning by morning he wakens to hear, to listen as those who are taught. The Lord God has opened my ear, and I was not rebellious. I did not turn backward. I gave my back to those who struck me, and my cheeks to those who pulled out the beard. I did not hide my face from insult and spitting. The Lord God helps me, therefore I have not been disgraced. Therefore I have set my face like flint, and I know that I shall not be put to shame. He who vindicates me is near. Who will contend with me? Who will stand up together? Who are my adversaries? Let them confront me. It is the Lord God who helps me. Who will declare me guilty? The responsive reading is from Psalm 31. Have mercy on me, O Lord, for I am in trouble. My eye is consumed with sorrow, and also my throat and my belly.
For my eyes are wasted with grief, and my ears are sighing. My strength fails me because of affliction, and my bones are consumed.
I am the scorn of my enemies, a disgrace to my neighbors, a dismay to my acquaintances. When they see me in the street, they avoid me.
Like the dead, I am forgotten, out of mind. I am useless for the wrong eye.
Well, I have heard whispering of the crowd. Fear is all around. They put their heads together against me. They plot to take my life.
But as for me, I have trusted in you, Lord. I have set my mind on my God.
My times are in your hand. Rescue me from the hand of my enemies and from those who persecute me.
Let your face shine upon your servant. Save me from this steadfast love.
The second reading is from Philippians chapter 2. Let the same mind be in you that was in Christ Jesus. Although he was in the form of God, did not regard equality with God as something to be exploited, but emptied himself, taking the form of a slave, being born in human likeness. And being found in human form, he humbled himself and became obedient to the point of death, even death on a cross. Therefore, God also highly exalted him and gave him the name that was above every name, so that at the name of Jesus, every knee should bend in heaven and on earth and under the earth. And every tongue should confess that Jesus Christ is Lord, to the glory of God the Father. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
The 11th chapter.
Glory to you, O Lord.
When they were approaching Jerusalem at Bethage and Bethany near the Mount of Olives, Jesus sent two of his disciples and said to them, "Go into the village ahead of you, and immediately as you enter it, you will find tied there a colt that has never been ridden. Untie it and bring it. If anyone says to you, 'Why are you doing this?' just say this, 'The Lord needs it, and will send it back here immediately.'" They went away and found a colt tied near a door outside in the street. As they were untying it, some of the bystanders said to them, "What are you doing untying the colt?" They told them what Jesus had said, and they allowed them to take it. Then they brought the colt to Jesus and threw their cloaks on it, and he sat on it. Many people spread their cloaks on the road, and others spread leafy branches that they had cut in the fields. Then those who went ahead and those who were following were shouting, "Hosanna! Blessed is the one who comes in the name of the Lord. Blessed is the coming kingdom of our ancestor David. Hosanna in the highest heaven." Then Jesus entered Jerusalem and went into the temple. And when he had looked around at everything, as it was already late, he went out to Bethany with the 12. The Gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, O Christ.
Would you please be seated? I always feel like Palm Sunday is one of those days that's kind of divided in half. At least when I think about writing a message or how I sort of understand Palm Sunday. Palm Sunday begins with "Hail Him." Hail, He's the King. Hail, Hosanna in the highest. Hosanna is "Save us, save us," because they recognize Jesus as the Messiah. But it goes from "Hail Him" to "Nail Him" very quickly. All we know is that the crowds gathered to hail him, and the crowds gathered to nail him. And so that's kind of the movement of Palm Sunday into Holy Week. If you read the posts on Facebook, many of them are wonderful, right? They talk about what life is all about. They talk about birthdays. That's one of the main reasons I'm on Facebook. Births, weddings, happenings, trips, vacations, all sorts of wonderful things that you're invited into. The posts that people like seem to proclaim life as something you find in beauty. Some of the most beautiful pictures I've ever seen have been posted on Facebook. Something you express in love, right? Life is also in love. And something you discover when you discover your true self, when you suspend yourself long enough that you can begin to learn something about who you are. This rejoicing part is how Palm Sunday begins. It's why we have the kids process around and wave palms. They may not even know why they're doing it, right? And I think there were many people on Palm Sunday who didn't know why they were doing it either. But the palms were taken from the trees. People threw their coats and their cloaks down. They threw a coat down on the back of this donkey. The word is often called colt, but it's literally the word for donkey. So they put a cloak over that, and Jesus sits on that. Why was that? Because the king never touched the ground, right? That's why you see a king sitting in his throne with his feet up on something. The king doesn't touch the ground. Right? And so it's kind of the beginning of the red carpet, right? We have at the Oscars and other things. And so that's what they were doing. That's the Palm Sunday part of life. Palm Sunday, Jesus rides into town and people cheer wildly. Hosanna, he's our king. And what can the king do that no one else can do? The king can pardon. The king can take someone who's guilty, who deserves punishment, who did something wrong, and he can say, "Go free." And so they call Jesus the king. Blessed is the one who comes in the name of the Lord. Sometimes life is celebrated on the mountaintop. And I know you have had many of those times where all of a sudden you feel, wow, this is a great day. It's not snowing. It's getting warmer. I walked to church today. I could hear birds singing all over. It's coming. Sometimes life is celebrated on the top of the mountain, but sometimes it's not. Today's gospel sets up the underside of life as well. The grief, the loss, the despair, realizing that life can also push us back down the mountain. I'm always surprised and I'm always thankful that our readings don't seem to shy away from either one, right? They don't shy away from the celebration and the amazing resurrection and new life. He is risen. And it doesn't shy away from the really hard times either, like Good Friday. Don't dismiss the bad part. Don't dismiss walking down the mountain this next week called Holy Week. It's where we get the best parts of life. It's where we get formed. I think that's why we call it Holy Week. Why would we call it Holy Week? I mean, we have the Last Supper, not the First Supper, but the Last Supper. Then we have the death of Christ, so terrible that we call it Good Friday, right? And then we have 3 days in the tomb. We know that Easter is coming, but don't be afraid to walk through Holy Week as well. It's where we get caught up in vulnerability and surprise. We get caught off guard, and all of a sudden we think, well, life is starting again. Spring is here. The disciples will be grieving soon as they see Jesus die and get buried. Life is born from love, and it deepens love as we journey along. But grief and loss can blur our vision if we think it's the last word, right? Grief and loss can invite us to collapse into ourselves if we think it's the last word. And it can block us from new and abundant life if we think it's the last word. We can begin to trust in our own disappointments sometimes, and we can fail to see God and fail to see his surprises. You get that on Facebook too. After each loss, we reach a point where we must ask ourselves this question: how do I begin to reinvest again in life? How do I start over again? Do I get a second chance? Is there a resurrection? Is there a redemption? Is there new life after this struggle that I'm going through? And Jesus says to us today, yes, there is. By going through the loss, by surviving the hurt, by picking up your cross. The disciples in the crowd put it this way. I think these are some of the saddest words in all of Scripture. Three sad words. We had hoped. That's what we're going to be hearing this week as we call Holy Week. We had hoped that he was the one. We had hoped that he was the Messiah. Do you remember the excitement when he rode into town and everyone recognized him as their king? Right? We had hoped that he was the one. But now look at him. He's on the cross. Now look at him. He's in the tomb. Now look at him. We had hoped. So speak those words. Recognize those words. Wrestle with those words. Own those words if you want. But don't get stuck in those words. Don't worship your fears. Don't worship your disappointments. Loss is an invitation back to God and back to his surprises. A real, deep, and sustaining hope is coming. And it does not come from posting inspiring words on Facebook, nor does it come from insulating yourselves from politics or fear or shallow people. Hope is always born in suffering, but it also is able to know that suffering does not have the last word. Do you want a love that can look into the face of betrayal or suffering? You want a love that can look down into the grave, maybe even jump down into the grave yourself, but still rise from the dead? Do you want a love like that? If you do, then you're looking for the God who can reach into the grave and pull you out. You're looking for the Christ who rides into town. Here's one last hopeful line for you to remember this Holy Week. There is no hell from which resurrection is impossible with God. Not the coronavirus, not the death of your loved one, not a broken relationship, and certainly not some dumb or offensive post on Facebook. God is bigger than that, and so are we.
Jesus, we give you the glory.
of faith using the words of the Apostles' Creed.
I believe in God, the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord. He was conceived by the power of the Holy Spirit and born of the Virgin Mary. He suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended into hell. On the third day he rose again. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen.
Trusting God's promise to reconcile all things, let us pray for the church, for those in need, and for all of God's good creation. Dear God, as we journey through Holy Week, bless our faith, our compassion, and our hearts, that we would be open and vulnerable. And as we are blessed by God's grace, let us be embraced by a love that transforms our lives. We give thanks this morning for the Trinity Choir, for Shirley Tranquil, for our kids and their enthusiasm, for Patty and Jay, and for moments of fellowship. Lord, in your mercy. Lord, we pray for an end to fighting in Israel and Palestine, in Russia, Ukraine, and other places where violence is practiced. Strengthen the people who have suffered loss and allow healing and recovery to begin. Lord, in your mercy. Gracious God, bring healing and strength to those who are sick or hurting. We pray this morning for John Condell, Paul Coffin, Goob Robotham, Sarah Fott, and Deb Golick's brother Tom, along with Bill and Marilyn, Randy, Carl, and Sharon, Scott and Holly, James, Ida, and Barb, for Jim and Bob and Karen and Amy, Chuck, Sue, and Chris. We pray for Phil and Clark, and for the names we carry in our hearts. Lord, in your mercy.
Amen.
We offer flowers in celebration of Nancy Vanderlinde's birthday, and we pray for her health and her happiness. May she have a celebration today. Lord, in your mercy.
Amen.
Into your hands, O Lord, we commend all for whom we pray, trusting in your mercy through your Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord.
Amen.
May the peace of our Lord be with you always.
Amen.
Please take a couple moments to greet those around you in peace.
Ha ha. Take our moments and our days. Let them flow and see.
which he is betrayed, our Lord Jesus took bread, gave thanks, broke it, and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take and eat. This is my body given for you. Do this for the remembrance of me." Again, after supper, he took the cup, gave thanks, and gave it for all to drink, saying, "This cup is the new covenant in my blood, shed for you and for all people for the forgiveness of sin. Do this for the remembrance of me." Let us join together in our Lord's Prayer. Our Father, who art in heaven,
hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us.
And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever.
Amen.
Please be seated, but come, for all things are ready, and all people are welcome at God's table.
Thank you.
beloved, we are God's own people, holy, washed, and renewed. God bless you and keep you, shower you with mercy, fill you with courage, and today give you peace.
Amen.
Wash with him one bitter heart. only missed it twice.
That's all, folks.